and welcome to another episode of FooBar. In today's video, we are going to talk about App Runner. App Runner is a service that allows you to easily deploy your web applications into the cloud. It's like the child that Fargate and Lambda had, maybe? So let's get started. The idea of App Runner is that you will deploy your applications without worrying about infrastructure, like you do with Lambda. The focus here is in the code, like you would do with Lambda. And the idea here is that you deploy applications, like you will do with Fargate or containerized application. So you can see why is the child that they had, because it mixed the two things, the two good things from both sides into this service. So here you can deploy your web applications, your simple application, not like functions, but like applications that you develop like applications into the cloud without really needing to worry about infrastructure. You can put these applications in a GitHub repo, no need to containerize them or anything. App Runner will do everything for you. And then the moment you do a commit to GitHub with a change, App Runner will take that and build and deploy the application. You can also use Docker images if you want and put them in ECR, in the container registry, but that's one way, but you can also do it directly from GitHub without even thinking about Dockerizing your application. If you want, you can configure in what kind of machine this is going to run. You can define how many virtual CPUs it will have, how much memory, but if you don't do it, it just will take the default and will do it for you, but you have those leverage as you have with Lambda, that you can define what kind of memory you want. Here you can define the amount of CPU and the amount of memory. And when this application is built and is deployed in the cloud, you will get a public endpoint that you can basically share around and use it. If you have a web application there, you can just basically connect it and boom, you have your application. If you have deployed your backend application, boom, you can use it in your frontend and whatever you imagine. App Runner takes care of scaling that application, so it will deploy as many instances as needed, and also will take care of the load balancing of the application. If you have multiple instances, it will direct the traffic to the right places. So you don't need to do it and you don't need to worry about it. You can define how many minimum instances you want, how many maximum if you want, or you don't need to. You can define how much a request an instance with those capabilities can handle, and then from there, App Runner will take care of everything. App Runner comes like Lambda and other serverless services in a pay-as-you-go model. The thing here is that you don't have a scale to zero way. It's like a container application, it has always something running, so you don't end up in this kind of cold start situation. So there is some idle time, but it's quite low compared to other container solutions, and we will go into those details later on the video, so stay tuned. So in a nutshell, this is the experience that you will have when working with App Runner. The development team will push an image to ECR or to GitHub, and then that will then start build and deploying time in App Runner. App Runner will do it. It will put it in the instances, and then you will get an URL that you can use from different DP clients or apps or customers can use that endpoint. When you define an App Runner service, you need to define the compute you want. You can define how many virtual CPUs you have one or two, and then you can define it with different memory configurations. For one virtual CPU, you have 2, 3, or 4 gigabytes of memory, and for a 2 virtual CPU setup, you have the 4 gigabytes of memory. So these configurations you can use, and that will define the size of the instance, and you can have from one instance to as many as you need. And here, when you are working with this compute, you need to find the maximum concurrent request that the instance can take. And this is how App Runner will scale up. So you will have, for example, an instance can take a maximum of requests. And then when there is 31, or it will do it before, it will start launching another instance. The traffic will get balanced between these two instances, and you will always have more and more capacity. You can also define a minimum amount of instances. So if you know that you have, I don't know, 100 requests, and then you will have 2 instances can take, I don't know, 30 requests. So you will have 2 instances always, and you can define also a maximum amount of instances, so you will not go over your budget or the amount of space you need. So in that case, then those requests will get throttled. So when a service is running, you have the service URL that will be in front and it will be load balanced. So AppRunner will take care of distributing the traffic. You will have a lot of active instances. These are the instances that are processing requests, and you have idle instances. And in this case, we have three active instances because maybe you have the maximum concurrency for each of the instances is, I don't know, 10, and you have 30 requests, so then it will be 10 requests per instance, and then you will have this idle instance that is not active, that is not processing any request, and this one might be because you have set up like you want a minimum amount of instances of 4, but you don't have enough requests to process, so this one is idle. Let's look at the concurrency. As I said, if you have a maximum concurrency of 10, you will have these 30 requests incoming and you will have 10 requests per instances. You can also set the concurrency, for example, for 30, and then the instance will take the 30 requests. And this is something you might need to test for your specific application. It will require a little bit of calibration. This is serverless in the sense of that it will scale out, but it's up to you to define what is this number. So you need to do some balancing out and how much compute those requests take. So let's look a little bit more on the auto-scaling part so it's easier for you to understand how this works. So we have the maximum concurrency set to 30, we have a minimum amount of instances of 3, and a maximum 5. So these are, we will go from 3 instances to 5 instances, and currently we have 20 requests. So it's coming those 20 requests, and we will only will have one active instance. The other two instances are idle, and that means that they are there, they are provisioned, but they are not really taking requests. And we will see this in the pricing, how this affects the whole thing. So this instance that is active is taking the 20 requests. Now the load increased to 75. And again, we have the same scenario. We have 30 maximum requests, 3 minimum and 5 maximum instances. And you can see here that now the 3 minimum provision instances are the 3 active and they are taking 25 requests each. And because we are so close to the edge, we are in the 75 request, and basically each of these ones can take 30, that fourth instance is getting prepared, is getting launched. So then requests come in, if there is an increase, there will be an instance ready to serve these ones. So now suddenly we have 100 requests and we have not yet got this fourth instance ready. So it's long. When that happens, we have these 10 requests that cannot be served in any of the provision instances queue. They are queue and they're waiting for the instance to launch. When the instance launch, now we are going to serve those requests that were queue into the new instance, and it's active as well. Now we have a load of 200, but we have a maximum of 5 instances that we can provision. So there will be 50 requests that will be dropped, or they will be queued to be processed when the other instances finish processing. So this is something that you need to have in mind. It's not with Lambda, for example, that it will scale unless you have set up the maximum concurrency. Here is like this 30 requests is the maximum amount of requests each of these instances can take. And then you can configure that number to whatever is good for you. But then the things are getting to be throttled. So now let's go to the console and see how this looks. I will show you what I have created, okay, in next week's video. So subscribe and stay tuned. But I want to show you a little bit of the console. So this is AppRunner. I have one service running and we are going to deploy that next week. So don't panic. It's here. It has a service name. It shows that the status is running. It has a URL that we are going to look at in a moment. It has public traffic and it shows me when it's created. And if I open it, you can see here that this is the domain and the source is coming from this GitHub app. And if we open this GitHub app, it's a node application. It's an Express application. It's not containerized. It's just a Node.js Express application. It has the server there. It has the index file that will start this application. It will connect to Node in this case. It will do whatever. And everything is in this application. It's just standard Node application that implements the backend from an e-commerce. And this is running from this source. So whenever I push change to this GitHub repo, it will start building and deploying a new version of this service. So that's great. Here in the first page, you can see the logs. You can see the logs for the application when it's created. You can also go to the application logs here as well, so you can see what is happening in the cloud. You can see the different activities. In this case, I have not yet pushed a change because it just shows me when the service was created. But if it was a new deployment, you will see, oh, this has built again, for example. Then you can see the metrics of this service, and you can see different requests, the responses, how many errors you are getting in there, because I have not been running this for a while. Let's see if we increase the windows. You can see here some values when I was testing this out yesterday. You can see the amount of instances I had active, and so on and so forth. And you can access these metrics from CloudWatch, and I will show you next week video on how you can do that. Then you can enable X-ray if you want. I have not enabled it. And then when you enable X-ray, you are getting the observability and the tracing aspect, but this is a containerized application, so you can use OpenTelemetry API. You can do whatever you want and share your information with other applications. So that's something interesting as well. Then here is the configuration, and this is something I will show you how to do it with infrastructure as code next week. But you can see the repository provider. This one can be ECR. You can see here my connection, and this is a connection that you need to create for your GitHub profile. So basically you are giving permissions to AppRunner to connect to your GitHub and then get different repositories, and you can create them from the GitHub connections. Here you can have as many as you need. I have my GitHub here, and basically it just every time I push, it will be allowed to take that push and do something with it. I allowed it in all my repositories, so whenever I create a new service, if it's connected to my GitHub, it will work. But you can create these on a project by project level, repository by repository level. So let's go back to service and the configuration. Here you can see the branch. So you have a multi-branch strategy as well, where you have different services built for different branches. So you are using a Git flow thing where you have a branch for a feature or for different stages, you can use that as well. Here it shows the deployment settings, and this is automatic. It can be manual, meaning manual that you will need to go and redeploy the service. Automatic means that every time I change either the image or the make a pull request or a commit to this GitHub repo, it will start building and deploying again. Here you can find the build settings, and this one is for Node. So if you are connecting directly like I'm doing, it supports only Python and Node for now. For containerized applications, you can do something else, but this one you can only use Node and Python. So here I have the runtime. I have the port that this application is going to run on. I have the build command, so they can build the application. And then I have here the start command that is for my specific application, npm run backend. And here it says that the configuration is this one. If not, I could have, I think, an app runner YAML in the root of my project with all this configuration, and then I will not need to configure it here. I could have the configuration from the code. Then here I have different configurations. In this case, the service name, the compute. In this case, I have one virtual CPU and 2 GB of memory, and I have my environmental variables. You can pass directly strings, or you can pass secrets. I'm using here the secret manager, so I'm passing the secrets. When you create this, you will need to give permissions to AppRunner to access the secrets. I will show you this in the next week video. Then here it shows the auto-scaling part, and here you have the maximum concurrency. This, I have it to 100, you can increase it. I think 100 is quite small, it could have way more, but this is the amount of maximum sizes. I can have maximum 25 concurrent instances and then one minimum instance idle if there is no request like now. Then this is the health check, and basically this will trigger some kind of, I could have alerts and things like that around that. Then the instances needs to have a role associated with it. And here is the role. In this case, the role has access to Secret Manager. And then later on, as I build more features on it, I will give more permissions to that role. Networking, we have here. Observability, as I said, is off, and you can create tags. And then finally, if you want, you can have custom domains. I don't have any, but if you will have one, you can link it and then you're ready. So here you can basically pause this. So this, if you pause it, then the idle state will be totally to zero, and then no request will be triggered. Basically, now that I'm not using this, I could pause it. And then when I come back to work on my development, I could unpause it, I could resume it, but I will not do it now. I will forget that. Basically you just pause it and then you can resume the service, and then it will start scaling up if needed when it's resumed. But when it's in the pause state, it's basically not working. It's great for development. Then you can deploy this. So if you have the manual deployment, you can basically deploy it whenever you need. So after the tour of the console, let's go and look a little bit on the pricing, because the pricing is a little bit complex if you are not familiar with this. So it's priced on multiple variables. So the first one is you pay for the CPU and memory of active instances, and you only pay for the memory for the idle instances. So that's important to know, these two different pricings. Then you have a build fee that you're going to be billed every time you're building this. So if you have complex build processes, this happens the same with Amplify and other services that do builds, that you are getting charged for the time of build. So that's no problem. This applies from the source code. So when you need to build the thing, if you're using container images, this doesn't apply. Then you have a deployment fee every time you are going to deploy, $1 per service per month. So have that in mind. And this only applies for automated deployments if you have that enabled. If you're doing manual deployments, this doesn't charge you. And then you have the standard data transfer for AWS. So that's something also that appears. So let's look at some examples to understand the pricing in the memory. If you have, for example, these minimal free instances that are provisioned, and one is active and two idles, for the active one, you're going to pay for the memory and the CPU, and for the idle ones, you're only going to pay for the memory. The moment that you are going to start getting those idle ones into active, then you're paying for memory and CPU. And then for the one that is launched, until it's not getting more, getting requests while it's idle, it doesn't cost anything. So the moment that it starts getting something, then you are going to be paying for. So that's the video for me today. AppRunner is quite an interesting service, and I want to start building a little bit on top of it, because there is some workloads that really benefit from using AppRunner, like this node application. If you think that you know where this node application that I show you comes from, yes, it's from my lift and shift migration. And if you don't know what is that, I will leave you the playlist so you can see how to lift and shift an application from a traditional environment to serverless. And this is the e-commerce I'm showing you. I will show you way more on how to build this AppRunner application with CDK. And if the video is available, you are going to see it in screen now. If not, go and subscribe to my channel so you get notified next week when that video comes out. And with that, I say thank you, and I see you in the next episode of FooBar. Ciao, ciao!